Bible said to everything, there is a season and a time. Is it your time to establish your positive momentum? Is it your time to be everything that God has called and created you to be? Is it your time to take your business, your ministry, your concept, your ideas, your visions to a new level and a new dimension? Well then, I have written a book just for you. It is entitled Intentional Momentum. Once you establish your positive momentum, you will become unstoppable in achieving your dreams and your visions. This book will show you how. In it, you will find the strategy, the methodology that God has ordained for you to achieve success in every area of your life. Are you a momentum maker? My answer is yes, you are. Be blessed and stay supernatural. I really want to, all the preachers, all the teachers, all the fivefold ministry gifts that are present in the room today, please, whatever you do, do not hold another conference, another service, sing another song, teach, preach, or do anything else without compassion.
Yeah. Come on.
Yes, sir.
If you do, you run the risk of becoming a hardened rock that is so committed to principle that you never become committed to presence.
Sooner than late, you don't have to worry about tomorrow. It's gonna work out in your favor. Just keep your head.
Praise the Lord. This is Pastor Bill, and I'm excited about an opportunity that we have with all of our saints to engage in dialogue with our Book of the Month. For the past 2 months, we have had a Book of the Month for January and February. We will continue with the Book of the Month for the remainder of the year. And the Book of the Month for March is Elevate by Robert Glazer. Elevate by Robert Glazer. On Monday, March 29th, we will have our very first book discussion, and I am excited about it. It will be via Zoom, and that information will be forthcoming March 29th, 6 to 7:30. Hope to see you there.
And welcome to another Midweek Manna Bible study. We are so excited for the opportunity to be able to share God's word with you wherever you may be. Do me a favor, if you haven't already, like, comment, share, and subscribe. Let somebody know that Christ Church Midweek Manna Bible study is happening right now, and I'm excited about sharing this word with you tonight. Listen, of course, anybody that knows me knows Bible study is my favorite service out of the week. It affords us the opportunity to to really dive into God's word in a more detailed way than what we may be able to do during a Sunday morning worship experience. And I'm just excited to be able to share this word with you and break open the secrets of God and reveal the mysteries of the Lord through his word. Let's have a quick word of prayer before we dive into the lesson. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, O God, for your goodness and mercy. We appreciate you, O God, for the chance that you've allowed us to be able to worship with you, O God, today, and to be able to discover who you are through your word. I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus that everything that is shared on this evening, I pray, O God, would allow us, O God, to draw closer to you. Help us as we are going along the journey in our spiritual formation process. Now, God, I ask you, O God, that you would touch these lips of clay. I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus, O God, that you would speak through me. You are the greatest teacher in all the universe. So, Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus that you would just be God, be Abba, be our Father, be our teacher. And, Father, in the name of Jesus, we'll give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, friend, again, if you haven't already, do me a favor, like, comment, share, and subscribe right now. I don't want to assume that everybody watching knows who I am. My name is Pastor James. I'm the executive pastor here at Christ Church Apostolic, and I'm just excited to be able to share this word with you on tonight. Get your Bibles. Let's dive into God's word, okay? During the month of March, we are engaging in a brand new series entitled Her. What we are doing is we are diving into the unsung women in the Bible that have been used by God. And what we're doing is we're gleaning principles from their lives, from their experiences that ultimately impact not just the lives of females, but they also impact the lives of males as well. Pastor James, how are you teaching on women when you're a male, when you're a man yourself? Very easy. The same way that I teach on men is the same way that I should be able to teach on women. You see, we are ensuring, as Dr. Darius Daniels calls, we are ensuring that our patriarchy, or rather that our theology, is not infected by our patriarchy. So by no means do I claim to understand all of the complexities of being a female or being a woman. I am a man. Use a boy, Damon. That's what I am. So I'm excited to be a man. I'm glad I'm a man. I'm glad I'm not a woman. I'm glad I am what God made me. So by no means do I ascribe to a full understanding as to what it means to be a woman or the complexities of being a woman. By no means am I inciting a radical feminist movement during this Bible study, nor am I excluding the men from this Bible study. But what we are doing is very, very intentional. We are rediscovering the basic and fundamental truths about the purpose of and the purpose in both women and men that have been lost, if you will, lost to cultural values and the traditions of the world. And as a result, it has infected the Lord's church. So essentially what we're doing, and I shared this on Sunday, is that what we are doing is we're calling, this is a call to order, kind of reestablishing exactly the mind of God in us and how we can function properly as we are moving through this journey with him. So on Sunday, we establish a very solid infrastructure that we're going to be building on for the rest of March. Now, I won't use this time as a means to reteach the entire lesson. If you were not with us on Sunday, I want to strongly, strongly encourage you to go back and look at the teaching from this past Sunday. It's available on YouTube right now. It's also accessible on this Facebook page as well. So I want to encourage you, go back and get that lesson. There are some key principles in that teaching that I believe will impact you holistically. Now, the first woman that we discover during this series, the first unsung woman that was used by God that we talked about on Sunday, is our continued case study on this evening. And her name was Sheerah. S-H-E-E-R-A-H, Sheerah. Now, I'm teaching from the topic, the lineage, the life, and the legacy of Sheerah. If you are watching me right now, put that in the comments for me. The lineage, the life, and the legacy of Sheerah. Now, truthfully, I was really only able to hint and really scratch the surface as to the life and the revelation that is housed in understanding who Sheerah is and that could be gleaned from her life. I still won't be able to touch on all of it tonight, but I'll do my best to try to get out as much as we can, and we'll build on that as we're going through the coming weeks. This Sunday's message is really going to be a continuation, not of the same person, but of the same principles that I believe will be impactful to you. So let's go back to the text that we established on Sunday, and let's pick it up from there, okay? 1 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse number 23 through 24. You see that on the screen. Follow along with me. And Ephraim went into his wife, and she conceived and bore a son, and called his name Beriah, because disaster had befallen upon the house. Now let's stop there and get some contextual understanding. Whenever you're dealing with Sheerah, the first thing that you have to understand is that Sheerah was introduced into the world during a time of crisis. I'll say that to kind of give you some more understanding. Her brothers were killed in a battle. You see that in the preceding verses in 1 Chronicles 7. They were killed in battle with Gath, if you will. And when they attempted to raid Gath's cattle, the Bible says that ultimately they were slaughtered. And this brief narrative outlines her birth. This is why her brother, Beriah, is called Beriah, because his name, Disaster, had befallen his house. Now, again, so you have to see, give a context, that Sheerah is being born immediately after disaster, immediately after a crisis. So then, let's keep reading. The Bible says his daughter, talking about Ephraim, his daughter was Sheerah, who built both Lower and Upper Beth-horon and Uzan Sheerah. Now, Sheerah was what we are teaching on, diving deeper into tonight. Sheerah was what I like to call an anomaly. If you are an anomaly, you are someone that is a deviation from the common rule. You're a deviation from a typical norm. You're a deviation from the normal arrangement or the normal form, if you will. There's always been something special or something different about you. Nothing normal ever accommodated your personality. Some people may call you a weirdo, but by definition, you are an anomaly. Anomalies are not the type, or rather they are the type to easily become irritated by mediocrity. They are easily irritated by the norm. They are easily irritated by things that are less than excellent, and everybody else may call them, they may call them over the top, if you will, but the anomalies, they see something special about the scenario that they are in, about the environment that they are in, and they bring something special to that environment. Fitting into the mold, the common mold, if you will, was never really a page, a part of their narrative. There was something different, another paragraph that wasn't in the life of everybody else, that there was something special about that anomaly. And I shared with us on Sunday that being formed with a rare design called anomaly is a diagnosis unto death. I hope you caught that. Being an anomaly is a diagnosis unto death. When an individual embraces their design, embraces their design as an anomaly, it's a death to conformity. It's a death to unfulfilled appetite, unfulfilling environment, unfulfilled atmospheres, unfulfilled systems. Some people may call them strange because it's almost as if they are seeking for environments that are not normal. They're not the same mold, but rather they're actually seeking for something that appeals to the puzzle piece that God has made them to be able to fit in this world and in this life. So follow me along with this. It is not only a diagnosis of death, but it is a diagnosis as unto discovery. It is a discovery of, or into rather, the worlds only understood by anomalies. Anomalies understand that there are environments, there are atmospheres, there are worlds that they are called to function in. Whether it is in entertainment, whether it's in ministry, whether it's in music, whether it's in business, so on and so forth, that they are called to operate in, but they cannot do it if they are functioning according to the mold. They are an anomaly. Sheerah understood this very well. She was very familiar with this type of lifestyle. Now, before we go any further, let's kind of address the elephant in this virtual room, if you will. Half of y'all right now don't know who Sheerah is. And I would venture to say most of us have never heard of Sheerah prior to either Sunday's teaching or even tonight's teaching. But that's okay. We're going to be really dealing with her more this evening. And I really want you to see where Sheerah comes from and where this anomaly type of lifestyle and this anomaly type of living comes from with her. Now, the foundational understanding that we have to have according to Sheerah, or rather of Sheerah, according to the scriptures, is that Sheerah was a brilliant builder. Sheerah was the architect of three cities, if you will. Sheerah was a developer. Sheerah was a visionary. Sheerah was a mastermind. All at the same time, it was packaged in a woman. Now, this is when you study Sheerah, she is the only reference in the Old Testament scripture that is a woman that has built any cities. That's important for us to know. And there were two primary reasons why many of us have never heard of Sheerah that I started on Sunday that we're going to expound on tonight. Now, there are two reasons. Number one, she appears in a part of the Bible that the average Christian tries to or generally skips over, and that is genealogies. Number two, the second reason why many of us have missed her in the scripture is because her name only appears one time in the entire Bible, in one verse in the entire Bible, and when she comes up, it's in passing. Now, I'll do my best to bring life to these points of information and bring revelation to these as well. But I need you to be an attentive group of scholars tonight in order for us to connect the dots between information and revelation. Now, let's deal with genealogies. When you study genealogies in the scriptures, genealogies are written or oral expressions of descents of a person or persons from an ancestor or ancestors. I'll say it again. Essentially, when you read the scripture, when you're dealing with genealogies, it is he begat her, he begat him, they begat that, so on and so forth. And you'll find them predominantly in the historical books in the Bible. Now, don't let that terminology intimidate you. The text that is classified as historical books, it belongs to two different traditional Jewish classifications. You have the writings, and then you have the prophets, or the former prophets, if you will. That's broken down into major and minor prophets as well. So those texts would include Ruth. That would include 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Ezra. That'll include 1st and 2nd Kings, the Judges. That'll include Joshua, so on and so forth. So all of what we're reading now is in a compilation of books called the historical writings. Now, you'll find not just genealogies in the Old Testament, but if you skip over to the book of Matthew and the book of Luke, I believe it is, as well, you'll discover that when they are outlining and introducing us to the Christ, to the Messiah, to Jesus Christ, they are introducing him by the means of genealogies. Now, why is that important for us? It is very vital for us because here's the principle that you have to get. Genealogies are specifically for the purpose of identity. Again, genealogies are specifically for the purpose of identity. What are you telling me, Pastor James? Go back and get the principle from Sunday. There is revelation in the root. I'll say it again. There is revelation in the root. So you have to get it. Any great builder of the future has to first be an historian. Listen, any great builder of the future first has to be a historian. Because I'm telling you from firsthand experience that if you get this wrong, you'll endanger yourself of trying to repeat when God doesn't build duplicates. If you are going to be a great builder of the future, you have to be a historian, not for the sake of duplicating history, but for the sake of understanding history and understanding where you come from and the shoulders that you are standing on. Now get it. I said it before, I'll say it again. There is revelation in the root. Put that note in the comment section. There is revelation in the root. Now, please listen to me. I believe that everybody watching me now, if you are designed by God, you have a prosperous future. I believe that everybody that is watching me now, I believe that God has a world that you have not been exposed to yet. I believe that God has a strong desire to be able to create something in you that you have not, that has not come out of you yet. God has big plans for your life. But I need you to have the correct understanding of this before you start another business, before you launch another project, before you jump into another relationship, okay? Before you involve yourself in another area of ministry, listen, sustainability can be discovered in your history. I'll say it again. Sustainability can be discovered in your history. And the challenge that many have, specifically anomalies, a lot of people have this challenge and they believe that being an anomaly is synonymous with being autonomous. Okay? Being an anomaly, this is the belief, being an anomaly is synonymous with being autonomous. Meaning what? Now, don't get me wrong. There are some journeys as an anomaly that you are going to have to take by yourself. The road will be lonely. So let me kind of brace you for that now. But here's the key. If the scripture teaches us in Ecclesiastes chapter 1 at verse number 9, I believe it is, the Bible says that there is nothing new under the sun, then that says to us that your giftings, that your calling, that your anointing, that your talent, while it may be unique to you, and while it may be unique to the time and the specific people and the specific area that you are called to, listen, unless you are Jesus the Christ, the earth, or rather what is in you, has occupied the earth before. I'll say it again. Unless you are Jesus, unless there is something in you where you are the Messiah and didn't tell nobody, at some point in time in history, the anointing, the gifting, the calling that is on you has occupied the earth at some point. Now get it. You are just a different manifestation of it in a specific time, in a specific season, into a specific people. The scripture teaches us about David in the book of Acts 13 and 36, that David, listen, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, he fell asleep. Now catch me on this. David was an anomaly in his day. He was an anomaly in leadership. He was an anomaly in worship, an anomaly for a model of succession, among other things as well. But David, listen, David was not an island within himself. David stood on the shoulders of men like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Moses. So that what we have to have an understanding of is, listen, while you may be an anomaly, you are not autonomous. So I want you to get out of your mind that you can't trust nobody. I feel that. You got to get out of your mind that you can't trust nobody, or nobody understands you, or nobody gets me. I'm out here by myself. Jesus, where the people at? Jesus. God, oh my God, I'm just carrying this. Stop it. Okay? Stop it. You are not by yourself. The scripture says that there is nothing new under the sun. While you may be in an anomaly, you ain't get here by yourself. You are not an island within you. You should see your face. You are not an island within yourself. You are standing on the shoulders of somebody. Now catch the principle again. There is revelation in the root. And this is what Sheerah is teaching us. Now, if you study this on the surface level, and by the way, Sister Aretha did an amazing job earlier this afternoon teaching on Sheerah. I want you to go back and listen to that lesson. She brought up a very interesting point. She said, if you study Sheerah on the surface level, you only glean a small portion of truth. While it will be helpful, there are deeper wells that we can dive into for us to be able to have more of a better knowledge of what she affords us. Now, Sheerah's history, listen, Sheerah's history affords us the knowledge that Sheerah was not an island within herself. She stood on the shoulders of those that went before her and those that were also designed as anomalies as she was. Now go back and pick up the text in 1 Chronicles 7 and verse number 23. Remember that when the Chronicles were written between chapters 1 through chapter 9, it is already providing for us the history of Israel dating back to Adam in the book of Genesis all the way up to the period of restoration after the Babylonian exile. And in the text we are studying, it is highlighting for us right here in chapter 7 in the verses that we are dealing with, it is highlighting for us the tribe of Ephraim. Look at the scripture, verse 23. The Bible says, and Ephraim went into his wife, and she conceived and bore a son. We talked about that coming from Beriah. Verse 24, and his daughter was Sheerah, who built both lower and upper Beth Horon and Uzan Sheerah. Now, there's a theological debate, if you will, as to whether or not Sheerah was the daughter of Beriah or whether Sheerah was the daughter of Ephraim. I ascribe to the belief that Sheerah was the daughter of Ephraim. Now, when you study this in your own time, I want you to come to your own theological conclusion, but I'm going to give you my reasons of why I am anchoring us in the belief that Sheerah was the daughter of Ephraim. There is revelation that is tied to that, that there is no way, I believe, there is no way that Beriah could be the father because of something that flows down from Ephraim. Let me explain. I want you to see where Sheerah's design comes from. Now, let's go back and get the history. Remember that Sheerah is the daughter of Ephraim. Who is Ephraim? Ephraim was the younger son of Joseph and Asenath, I believe it is. She was the Egyptian wife of Joseph. Now, Ephraim's older brother, listen, was Manasseh. Come on, Sunday school class. The father of Joseph was who? Jacob. There you go. Somebody was about to say Noah. That's not right. Okay? The father of Joseph was Jacob. Now, let's connect the dots, if you will. at the conclusion of Jacob's life in Genesis 48, when Joseph went to see his father while he was sick, the Bible says that he took Manasseh and took Ephraim, his sons, with him. Now, not only does Jacob adopt Manasseh and Ephraim as his own sons, but the Bible teaches us that Jacob pronounces the patriarchal blessing. He puts the patriarchal blessing upon Manasseh and Ephraim. Now, here's what's critical about this. In this particular Hebraic culture, or is Israelite culture, if you will, Manasseh, because he was the firstborn, he was supposed to receive the larger blessing that came from Jacob because he was born first. But listen, The Bible is very unique where it teaches us that Jacob does something that is countercultural when it comes to Ephraim. The Bible says, as Joseph, he brought his son to Jacob and he guided them to Jacob, so much so that the Bible says that he guided Manasseh to Jacob's right hand and guided Ephraim to Jacob's left hand. But the Bible says that Jacob does something that is very unique. When Jacob gets ready to pronounce and lay hands upon Manasseh and Ephraim, the Bible says that he crossed his hands. He laid his right hand on Ephraim, woo, and he laid, And he laid his left hand on Manasseh. The scripture teaches us that Joseph got upset. Look at verse number 18. The Bible says, and Joseph said to his father, he said, no, daddy. He said, not this way. He said, since this one is the firstborn, put your right hand on him. But his father refused and said, I know my son. I'm old, but I ain't dumb. He said, he also shall become a people, but he also shall be great. Here it is. Nevertheless, his younger brother Ephraim shall be greater than he, and his offspring, I love God's word, and his offspring shall become a multitude of nations. Catch me now. So you have two generations, man, of countercultural actions. You have Ephraim that was born to a father who was Joseph, whose life itself is countercultural. Joseph was born to Jacob and Rachel in their old age, and his existence itself is a miracle because his brothers were jealous of him and they wanted to kill him. They sold him into Egyptian slavery. And the Bible says that when he becomes a slave, as time moves forward, he is a foreigner in Egypt, but as a result, he gains the highest position in Pharaoh's court. He's running all of Egypt, but he's a foreigner. Now, so not only that, but Joseph was responsible, listen, for being the spiritual and the natural visionary to exercise quality leadership and management during a time of famine in Egypt. Joseph built warehouses in the city of Egypt that the surrounding cities would come to Egypt and to be able to get supplies or get food and what have you from him. Now, here's what's powerful. Joseph was an anomaly. Go on to Ephraim's grandfather, Jacob. He was the biblical patriarch, and from him proceeded the 12 tribes of Israel. He was an anomaly. He was a crisscross. Woo-wee! God have mercy. You have a crisscross anointing. but hear me on this. Hear me on this. He was an anomaly. So if I had time, I would trace it all the way back to Isaac and to Abraham. But here's what I want you to see. I want you to see this. The blessing and the design of being an anomaly was on Ephraim. And in Ephraim, it was passed down from him, from Joseph, and from Joseph, it was passed down from Jacob. And from Jacob, it was passed down from Isaac, and from Isaac, it was passed down from Abraham. I really want you to understand this. So then, as a result, this same anointing, this anomaly, if you will, it trickles down to Ephraim and then Ephraim's daughter, Sheerah. So Sheerah was a builder like her grandfather. The only difference was while her grandfather was building in cities, Sheerah was building cities. Sheerah was blessed like her father. You see, this visionary gift that was passed down from her grandfather to granddaughter, from father to daughter, was not rooted in gender, but it informs us that the gift of creativity, intelligence, the design of being an anomaly comes from God. Let's dig deeper. So just because the Bible only gives us one verse of her, she has a well of history. Listen, she has a well of history, a well of anointings, a well of blessings, a well of relationships, what? With God behind her that are backing her up. God have mercy. Now, I told us on Sunday that never be defined by the length of someone else's explanation of who you are. See, so while my sentence, listen, while my sentence may not be impressive, my impact will leave an impression. I'll say it again. While my sentence may not be impressive, my impact will leave an impression. Let me free some of you that are watching me right now. You, come on, say this with me. Follow along. You, say it, you have nothing to prove to anybody. I'm going to say that again. You have nothing to prove to anybody. All you got to do is build your cities and let your work talk. You see, what bothers me most about people who are building stuff is a lot of them talk too soon. You're putting up Facebook posts and Facebook statuses and carrying on. I'm building. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. Some of the greatest builders build in silence. Come on with me, y'all. And so sometimes you got to learn how to allow your work to do more talking than you do. Oh, come on now. So Pastor James, what if I'm not one of the ones that have a long history like Sheerah of Ephraim's in my life, or Joseph's in my life, or Jacob's in my life, or Isaac's in my life, or Abraham's in my life? If that's what you're focusing on, you miss the entire revelation. You see, you keep focusing on the anomalies themselves. But what I'm trying to get you to see is the God of the anomaly. God. So God, if God used Jacob and God used Ephraim, God used Joseph and God used Ephraim, God was not using them simply as a medium to get an anointing down to Sheerah. God was using them, woo, I feel that. God was using them as a point of reference to say, if I did it through them in their time, I can do it through you. You see, I don't know if I can, man, that thing snuck up on me. You see, if I can defy the odds in their time, I can defy the odds through you. You see, if I can make a Hebrew run Egypt, I can make you run a whole city. I can do that through you. If the people before you can get out of slavery, I can get you to be a CEO and hire your own people. Come on now. So what I need you to see is you've got to learn how to stop using what you think you don't have in your past or the resources that you think you don't have as an excuse not to be who you are. Come on, Sheerah and Bill. Come on here. You got to stop demonizing your difference. If he is the same God, Yabandoria, and he is the same God that worked through them can work through you. Do you see it now? So living in some, I'm almost done, living in someone else's definition focuses you on a misinterpretation of your difference. And then it becomes the difference between you living in good and living in great. Jim Collins, he said that good is the enemy of great. Sheerah, while you're a good thinker, but embracing, listen, Sheerah, while you're a good thinker, embracing your difference could make you a great builder. Do you follow me? So you have to learn how to move from good to great by embracing your difference. So what is it in your life that is good that you settled in? Why be okay with building one city when there's three in you? Why be okay with one book when you got five in you? Why be okay with owning one piece of property when you can own the whole block? Y'all don't want to hear me. So what has God put in you that you have successfully tucked away because you have not embraced the fullness of your difference yet. Now, here's what I love most, and here's where I'll close. Remember that I told you that one of the primary reasons that we don't hear about Sheerah is because she was tucked away in genealogy. And number two, she's only mentioned in the Bible one time. Now get it. Although her name did not repeat, it lived on in the scriptures through the cities that she built. Sheerah's cities lasted for centuries after her death. You see it in Joshua 18. You see it in the 250 years after Sheerah built her cities and God protected them. The Bible teaches us in 1 Kings that Solomon fortified her cities. In 2 Chronicles 8, I believe it is, it explains that Solomon only added walls and towers and bars to the city. So you see that the city was built on a firm foundation. It lasted longer than she did. Solomon did not have to relay the foundation that Sheerah had. While Solomon was an anomaly, he did not have to relay her foundation. He had to just build on her foundation. What are you telling me, Pastor James? I'm almost done here, guys. Here we go. I'm telling you, if you allow the same God that worked through them to work through you, your work will outlive you. If you allow the same God that worked through them to work through you, your work will outlive you. But you have to be mature enough to say, if they don't mention my name, I'll let my name live through my work. Yes. I know you're gifted. I know that you can change the world. I know it's in you to be different. I get that. But could it be that God is trying to get you to the point where he can use you even if they don't know your name? Man. Could it be that God is trying to get you to the point where he can use you if your name never blows up? Could it be that God is trying to get you to the point that before I let somebody have a revelation of you, I'll let them live in your work before I reveal who you are? You're anointed. You're an anomaly. But if they never recognize you, as long as they see him, that's all that matters. As long as they see him, that's all that matters. That's the common denominator in the lineage of Sheerah, in the life of Sheerah, and in the legacy of Sheerah. We see God. Man. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you, oh God, that you will allow our lives to reflect Sheerah's. I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus, God, that you will allow you to be seen in our lineage, allow you to be seen in our life, allow you to be seen in our legacy. Father, keep on maturing us. Keep on building us. We know there is something greater in us. We know there's something bigger in us. But Father, in the name of Jesus, we'll abide by your time. We'll say yes to your will, we'll say yes to your process, and we'll keep on building. And Father, in the name of Jesus, ultimately, I ask you, don't let them see us, let them see you. Help us to mature into that. Help us to grow into that. And Father, we'll give you glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, friend, I hope that you were blessed by God's word tonight. If for some reason you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ and you want to know Jesus for yourself, call that number at the bottom of the screen. We have ministers that are waiting for you right now to walk you through God's plan of salvation for your life. That's the whole reason why we do what we do, is to ensure that somebody can see Jesus and to ensure that somebody is saved. Also, family, if you were blessed by the word of God tonight, do me a favor and sow into this ministry. I say it all the time. So where you grow. You see those three ways of giving at the bottom of the screen. I pronounce the blessing of the Lord upon you. God bless you, family. Looking forward to seeing you on this coming Sunday. I'm excited about the word of God that's going to be shared with you. God bless you, family. We'll see you soon. Remember, all they need to see is Jesus. God bless you.
Bible said to everything there is a season and a time. Is it your time to establish your positive momentum? Is it your time to be everything that God has called and created you to be? Is it your time to take your business, your ministry, your concept, your ideas, your visions to a new level and a new dimension? Well then, I have written a book just for you. It is entitled Intentional Momentum. Once you establish your positive momentum, you will become unstoppable in achieving your dreams and your visions. This book will show you how. In it, you will find the strategy, the methodology that God has ordained for you to achieve success in every area of your life. Are you a momentum maker? My answer is yes, you are. Be blessed and stay supernatural.
I really want to, all the preachers, all the teachers, all the fivefold ministry gifts that are present in the room today, please, whatever you do, do not hold another conference, another service, sing another song, teach, preach, or do anything else without compassion.
Yeah. Come on.
Yes, sir.
If you do, you run the risk of becoming a hardened rock that is so committed to principle that you never become committed to presence.
Sooner than late, you don't have to worry about tomorrow. It's gonna work out in your favor. Just keep your head.
Praise the Lord. This is Pastor Bill, and I'm excited about an opportunity that we have with all of our saints to engage in dialogue with our Book of the Month. For the past 2 months, we have had a Book of the Month for January and February. We will continue with the Book of the Month for the remainder of the year. And the Book of the Month for March is Elevate by Robert Glazer. Elevate by Robert Glazer. On Monday, March 29th, we will have our very first book discussion, and I am excited about it. It will be via Zoom, and that information will be forthcoming March 29th, 6 to 7:30. Hope to see you there.